praise God from whom all blessings flow. Let's give God some clap of praise. He's a good God, and I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord. I don't know about you, but I'm like David. David said, I was glad when they said unto me, come, let us go into the house of the Lord.
Yes.
And you know, today, this is the fifth Sunday. And I was thinking that, you know, there are four seasons to a year, four seasons, you know, the winter, spring, summer, and fall. But then there's a fifth season that God has given us. And that's called due season. And so we're in due season today. So I thank God for due season. So I thank God for that due season. So we're just going to give God some praise today, because how many of you know that every praise is to our God? That every praise is to our God. So join us today in worship. Let us worship Him.
Oh, come on, let's stand to your feet and give God some praise. It's just like Reverend Pat said, every praise is to our God. Come on, help us lift them up and say, every praise, is to our God.
Every word of worship,
on one accord. Oh, every praise,
every praise
is to our God. Oh, come on, sing hallelujah to our God.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
Glory, hallelujah. It's to our God. Every praise,
every praise,
it's to our God. Oh, come on, every praise,
is to our God.
Every word of worship, on one accord. Every praise,
every praise,
it's to our God. Oh, come on, help us say hallelujah to our God. Come on, everybody say glory, hallelujah. It's to our God. Oh, every praise,
it's
to our God. Oh, we're going to take it up right now and say every praise.
Every
word of worship. On one accord. Oh, every praise.
Every praise
is to our God.
Oh,
come on, help us sing hallelujah to our God.
Sing hallelujah to our
glory,
God.
Hallelujah.
Glory, hallelujah to our God.
Every praise,
every praise
is to our God. Oh, come on, say it.
Every praise is to our God.
Every word of worship. On one accord,
every praise
is to our God.
Sing hallelujah to our God.
When you see me dancing, every praise,
every praise.
Every praise is to our God.
Amen.
God is good. Let us go to the scriptures today.
Yes.
Where we're going to be reading from Psalms, the 150th chapter, beginning at 1 through 6. And we'll start reading together, if that's all right. Verse number 1 says,
Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with string instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals.
Those things that are weighing us down, that are troubling us, that have us wondering why, when. But I'm here to tell you that the God that we serve is an on-time God.
Yes.
That he may not come when you want him, but he's always on time. Amen. And we got to be encouraged this morning and know that God will not give us no more than what we can bear. Amen. And I want to thank God this morning for our sanctuary and for our candidates that's coming to the liquid grave today, Lord God, that they're going to go down old, but they're going to come up new to serve and do what God has called them to do. So let us stand in a gap today for those that have come to give their lives to Christ. Amen. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come, Lord, right now just to say thank you, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for this day, for this opportunity that you have allowed us to come to your house of worship one more time, Lord God, where we can come, Lord God, freely, Lord God, being able to worship, to praise, to bless, and to honor you, Lord God. Lord God, we know that when the praises go up, the blessings come down, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you right now for the candidates, Lord God, that will go into the liquid grave this morning, Lord God. Lord God, we ask that you would just wash them up, Lord God. Just clean them up, Lord God. And whatever, Lord God, their path was leading up to this day, Lord God, we know, Lord God, they are new, Lord God, that we not be judgmental, Lord God, that we would not look at their past, but, Lord God, just praise them for the future, Lord God. Lord God, we know you have called them to do a work, Lord God. And let them not just be people to come to church, Lord God, to sit on the bench, Lord God, but let them find their place here at Trinity, Lord God. What would you have them to do, Lord God, to serve you, Lord? And, Lord God, we thank you for the family members, friends that are here today, Lord God. Lord God, we ask you just to hear their prayers, Lord God, that you bless them, Lord God. And Lord God, for every man, woman, boy, and girl, Lord God, that's among us today, Lord God. You know what's on our minds, Lord God, because you made us and you know all about us, Lord God. Lord God, we ask that if it is your will, Lord God, that you give them the desires of their hearts, Lord God. And Lord God, let us remember, Lord God, that if you don't give it to us, Lord God, then it's not for us to have, Lord God. We have not because we ask not, Lord God. And when we come asking, Lord God, that we be obedient to your spirit, Lord God, and we accept those things, Lord God, that you allow us to go through in our lives, Lord God. Because, Lord God, you said that you are carrying us through, Lord God. That this journey of life, Lord God, is just a path, Lord God, that will lead us to the end, Lord God. At the end, Lord God, is the beginning with you, Lord God. And we thank you for the Holy Spirit that dwells in this place, Lord God. We ask that you dispatch your angels today, Lord God, to sit on the rooftop of Trinity, Lord God, that we will feel your presence in this place, Lord God. We thank you for those, Lord God, that are on the way, Lord God, and those that are here, Lord God. We lift up those, Lord, that are lost loved ones today, Lord God. Just continue to give them peace, Lord God, understanding, Lord God, comfort, Lord God. Let them know, Lord God, that you still love them, Lord God. And, Lord God, that they will see their loved ones again, Lord God. Just continue on this journey, Lord God. It's called life, Lord God. We praise and honor you today, Lord God. We thank you for our children, Lord God. We ask you just continue to bless them, Lord God. Lord, give them the desires of their hearts, Lord God. And as those that are getting ready to graduate from high school and from college, Lord God, let them know, Lord God, that they have to always remember what's in their toolbox, Lord God, and that's the power of the Holy Spirit that dwells inside of them, Lord God. So we pray right now that no weapon formed against them shall prosper, dear God, when they leave home, Lord God, to go out there, Lord God, to those colleges and universities that you have picked for them, Lord God. Lord God, and let them always find themselves somewhere on Sunday morning praising and honoring you, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for our pastor, this man of God, that you have blessed here at Trinity, Lord God. Just continue to build him up, Lord God, where he's weak, Lord God. Lord, just continue just to keep his mind stayed on you, Lord God, because he consistently preaches your word, Lord God, to men, women, boys, and girls, Lord God. Lord God, let no weapon forms against him to today shall prosper, dear God. Let him not get weary in doing well, Lord God. Let him stay on the road, Lord God. And let him just keep on keeping on, Lord God. Because, Lord God, we know that there's a crown in heaven waiting for him, Lord God. Every day there's another jewel put on that crown for this man of God, Lord God. We pray for his helpmate, his wife, Lord God. We ask you to continue, Lord God. Just to bless her, Lord God, as she stands on side of her pastor, Lord God. Lord God, that she's his helpmate, Lord God, and she will find herself wherever you have her to be, Lord God. We thank you for her spirit, Lord God. And Lord God, we thank you for every auxiliary in this church today, Lord God. Just build them up, Lord God. Lord, let us not worry about man, Lord God. Let us not sing for show or fashion, Lord God. Let us not pray for show or fashion, Lord God. Let us not preach for show or fashion, Lord God. But let us give all glory and all honor to you, Lord God. Because it's by your grace and your mercy, Lord God, we are who we are, Lord God. And we don't take these gifts for granted, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you for this time, Lord God. And we ask that you would just bless, Lord God, this service, Lord God. And as we leave this place today, but never your presence, we ask that you go out with us into this dying world, Lord God. That we will spread the good news, God, to someone who does not know you and pardon their sins. And until we come again, Lord God, we give you all praise and glory. And in Jesus' name, the church said amen and amen.
You may be seated. Now we'll turn it over to the hands of the baptism committee.
Bless us with one beautiful day to be able to come together and celebrate with our young people the reality and the fact that they have professed their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And to join in this baptismal moment with them, Reverend Tim has brought them through the Sunday school teaching. We know that they've been well versed in the Word of God, and we're excited about for their young age. And we're very excited about the step of faith that you are taking. And that fact that we can be a part of this process, be a part of the journey, that walk of faith that you're going through. It's an exciting time whenever we get to be a part of that, the church family. And we just want to thank God for you. Can we just give them a hand clap of praise even before we go? Thank God for you. Let us welcome Zaya Liddell. Zaya. So I see you put the phonetics on there, and I looked at it too. Zaya Liddell. Thank you. Come on. Mom, don't let me mess up these names, please. Please. I love the excitement. Zaya's been just so excited about getting to that baptismal day. Family was saying how quickly, every day she was asking, how close are we to it? And that's the kind of excitement and passion that you want, young and old, when we come to this moment in life. So, Zaya, we're so excited for you, hon. There you go. Reverend Tim's got you. Upon profession of your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and in obedience with the word of God, we baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Let's welcome Sharasia Cobbs. Yeah. raise you upon profession of your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, in obedience to his holy word. We baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Shariah Cobb. There you go. Shariah, upon your profession in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, in obedience to his holy word, we baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Welcoming Jason the Cobbs. This is a family affair, in case you haven't noticed. Amen. Jason, upon profession of your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and in obedience with his holy word, we baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost. Jonathan David Allen Murphy.
All right.
That's it. Just call me JD. Amen. Amen. JD, upon profession of your faith in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, personal Lord and Savior, in obedience to his holy word, we baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. Kyle Matthew Harvey. Amen. Kyle, upon profession of your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, in obedience to his holy word, we baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Welcome, Trinity Riggins. Trinity, upon profession of your faith in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, and in obedience to his holy word, we baptize you in the name of the Father, we baptize you in the name of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
One more time, let's give all of our baptismal family. God bless you all.
Can you stand? We're going to sing our morning hymn today. I am thine, O Lord. Fellowship time at Trinity. Let us greet our neighbors.
Good morning, family. God is good, and he's worthy. Aren't you glad? Amen. What a joyous day. Amen. So I have a few announcements today. I'm going to probably get through this quickly because I just got over the flu, and I feel a coughing attack happening in about 5 seconds. Amen. But we're going to get through this. Okay, so ladies, Saturday, May 5th, mark your calendars. This is probably the last reminder you may get this week. The women will be having their women's conference here at Trinity, right here on campus, May 5th, 8:30 to 1:30. Breakfast is included. The theme is Becoming Unstuck, Psalm 119:45, and I shall walk in a wide place, for I have sought your precepts. So ladies, invite some friends out. Make sure you come out. You know, this is what I like to call CE. You know how at your job you have continuing education, your job, you know, they send you out to these classes and conference so you can come back new and improved. Well, this is your way of becoming new and improved. Take care of yourself. So it would be this Saturday, right here at Trinity, from 8:30 to 1:30. Okay? Amen? Amen. Children's Church, I understand we will have that today for ages 2 and older, immediately after the mass choir selection. If you have any questions or if you would like to volunteer, please see Reverend Tim or Deborah McCloyne. Men, also mark your calendar, same day, May 5th, Saturday at 9:30, there will be a men's fellowship in the Family Life Center. You're going to continue your study that day as well. Reminder, second Sunday is Youth Sunday, so please get your good news over to Deanna. That's second Sunday, Youth Sunday. Get your good news over to Deanna before second Sunday. Amen? Amen. If you like a copy of the worship service, you can see anybody on the media team here to my right. Compassion Center will be open today after service from 1 to 2. If you have any questions about that, you can see Miss Betty Like. She's here somewhere. Reminder, tune in to WYLL, 1160 a.m., 7 p.m. every Sunday for life lessons with Bishop Love. Amen. Amen. And also, reminder, someone's going to be doing announcements next Sunday. I just don't know who. So, that's okay. You can send your announcements to tbcciannouncements@gmail.com. Somebody will get it, and they will read the announcements for you. Amen. Now, do we have any first-time visitors or returning friends? I do see a lot of new faces here. If so, if you can please stand. Good morning. I see you. Good morning. Good morning. I see you. Good morning. Thank you for worshiping at this time. If you can continue. See. There you go. Stand back up. So we're going to have ushers come around who's going to give you a visitor's card. If you can please fill that out. And then just place it in the offering plate. Thank you again for worshiping with us this Sunday morning. Amen. I'm doing good, guys. I don't feel the attack coming just yet. Amen. Okay, thought of the week. Thought of the week. You are the only Bible some unbelievers will ever read. Amen. Think about it. You never know. You never know who you're going to come in contact with. We are happy to be in the Lord's house here at Trinity Baptist Community Church. Our pastor is Bishop Dr. Michael J. Love. Trinity is a teaching ministry of God's holy word. We touch, share, love, and care, and thank God for this opportunity to praise and worship him. If you're looking for a church home when Bishop Love opens the doors of the church, please feel free to give your hearts to Christ and your hands in fellowship to Trinity. I made it. Amen. Amen. Have a blessed week, family.
Isn't this a beautiful day to be in the Lord's house? Come on, somebody. Yeah, it is so good to be here. So excited about our young people and their families on this this day of celebration that the Lord has absolutely blessed us with. And we have a lot going on, as you can tell from the announcements. I want to, first of all, add my voice in welcoming our congregation that's joining us via the live video stream broadcast that we're sending out of the service. We're praying that you'll be blessed by something that's been happening during the service, and it might touch your heart and draw you ever closer to the Lord, either in your beginning of faith or your walk of faith with him. So we'd love to hear from you. It's always good to get a note or get a voicemail on the phone that says we were watching the service and we were moved by something that was said or sung or prayed during that time or even taught. And so let us hear from you if you don't mind. God is good. We'd like to know we're touching some folk out there. We've got a lot going on, as Nicole has indicated. The next few days, this next month coming up is going to be another very busy month. As we look forward to this exciting women's conference, this is the 25th one we've done as a church women's conference. And it's exciting. We got some guest speakers, we got some conferences, workshops. It's going to be a great day on the Saturday. And invite some friends, invite some lady friends to come on out and share in that. And on the next Sunday, we'll be celebrating, on Mother's Day, we'll be celebrating our Women's Appreciation Service on that Sunday. So mark that down for a very special. You're kind of getting a twofer here, ladies. Did y'all schedule it that way? We'll carry it. That's a good move. We're really excited about that. We'll be doing some additional things as we look into the month of May also. Mark your calendars for that last Saturday in May. First Lady's over there, so I'll do the plug for her. That the Love Foundation will be pulling together a walk-run group for the Foxtrot. This is our second annual. We want to get about 100. We had 50 last year. We want to get about 100 walkers and or runners to join us in Elgin for the Saturday. Not only will it be a great opportunity for fellowship and a little bit of exercise, but it's for a great cause. We'll be raising, any funds raised out of that will go towards scholarshiping area-wide and any under-resourced young people who are heading towards our partner church. Our partner college this year will be Judson. So it gives us an opportunity as a foundation to scholarship some kids into the program, into the grant program that Judson has. So if you want to be a part of that cause, or if you just want to get out and have a good time, or if you don't feel like walking and you want to sponsor, see the First Lady, see Karen, Dr. Karen Love over there. I love seeing that. See the Dr. K over there. And let her know you're registering. That's the last Saturday. I don't have that date in my head. I'm going to mess that up. But mark it down and come and join us. A lot of great things. This afternoon, I'll mention, as I look at Reverend Yeshik there, we'll be having a 3 o'clock service, a memorial service in the chapel for one of our co-workers in the jail ministry. As you know, I'm the senior chaplain of the jail, McHenry County Jail Ministry also, and we've got a lot of great ministries that are involved there. And you may or may not know Michael Allen. He's visited the church a few times, but he's been working directly with Reverend Yeshik for years. How many years has it been? 15 years or so? He passed away this past week, and we're doing his service in the chapel at 3 o'clock today. So I want to keep all the friends and family prayed up during that time, and we'll come and celebrate the life. It was a good work in the jail ministry that they've done through Celebrate Recovery. That's a good work. Now, where you at, Deacon? Oh, there you are. Yeah, you know when you got a son that's been baptized in here. I got to get you up on stage. So while we're coming to worship and bless the Lord with our giving on this beautiful Sunday, let's ask the question: has the Lord blessed you this week? Has He done anything worthy of any praise in your life this week? Come on, give Him some praise like you really mean it. It's a beautiful day. Come on, Deacon.
God is good, and He is worthy. Aren't you glad? Amen. The Bible records, let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. Now, I know y'all not just sitting out there without breath. If the Bible says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord, why don't y'all praise the Lord and quit looking at me like it's something wrong with me? God is just too good to y'all to come in here and give him that old pity pat. Y'all, some of y'all pity pat, and I don't like old pity pat. Some of y'all pity pat. Y'all, too many of y'all pity pat. We just baptized all these folks this morning, and y'all come up in here pity-patting. Some of y'all need to run around the church. Glory to God. I know when I seen J.D. go in that water, I almost start running around the church. I might start crying up here. God is just too good to be messing around, be playing church. I'm going to read y'all a verse in a minute that's going to really tell y'all what y'all supposed to do. Glory to God. Look at these folks on this front row. Glory to God. Back in the day, they used to come from miles around to baptisms, and they used to have a Holy Spirit good time. We need to have the same thing, a Holy Spirit good time. Y'all look good. Y'all praise kind of weak a little bit, but we're going to work on that. I'm going to pray for y'all, and y'all pray for me. Glory to God. God is good. Won't he do it? Y'all ain't hear him. Won't he do it? Glory to God. I see you, Miss Master. I see you, Miss Master. Rev, that's JD's teacher over there, Rev. Rev, she nurtured him all the way up, Rev. Rev, you know the Lord talked to her, Rev. Come on. Y'all give it up. Glory to God. Some of y'all want me to stop talking, but I'm going to lead. I'm going to go with what the Holy Spirit say. Now, if y'all sure enough want to see something, if First Lady start playing that song, talking about they hung him high and they stretched him wide, y'all ain't saying nothing up in here. God is just too good. As the ushers come forward, it is Thanksgiving time. This is the part of the service where we get a chance to give back to God what's already his. Some of y'all need to jump in that plate. God is just too good. Deacon, some need to jump in the plate. That's how good the Lord has been. I know y'all. I know what y'all been doing. But God bless you anyhow. Hey, there's a word in Colossians. Please don't miss this. I will confess and be transparent. I got my son's Bible. Now, my Bible got the big print. I don't know what this is right here. Ram. I don't know. So y'all pray for me. I'm going to Colossians 3:17. Boy, you must got some good eyes, boy. And whatever you do, please don't miss this. And whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. Whatever you do, when you come to church, how you dress, how you praise, do it like you are a representative of God. Think about that. It's all about excellence. They used to say, sign your work, students, with excellence. Sign your work with excellence. This is all about the Lord. God is good. And he is worthy. Let's have all of our eyes closed, our heads bowed, and our hearts humbled as we all assume an attitude of prayer. Oh Lord, Father God, how excellent is thy name. Father God, we just want to thank you right now for waking us up this morning. You didn't have to wake us up this morning, Father God, but you saw fit to wake us up, and we just would like to say thank you. Father God, thank you so much for your amazing grace, Father God. Father God, thank you for your unmerited mercy. Father God, we know that you are the Alpha and you the Omega. Father God, you're the beginning and the end, Father God. There will not be another after you, Father God. We just want to say thank you, Father God, for just blessing us over and over again. Father God, bless each one of these children, these students, these boys and girls who were baptized today, Father God. Father God, bless them, Father God, from the crown of the head, Father God, to the soles of their feet, Father God. Bless them, Father God. Let them shine their light for you, Father God. And we just want to praise you over and over again. Father God, bless our pastor, Father God, as he brings that word today, Father God. And you know he's going to bring nothing but the word, Father God. Bless the first lady over there, Father God, trying to get me going. Because she's over there playing that song, Father God. Father God, we just thank you so much, Father God, for our first family, Father God. Keep them lifted up, Father God. Keep that hedge of protection. Keep that circle around each and every one of us, Father God. As we leave this holy place, Father God, protect us. Give us traveling grace, Father God. Wherever we're going, Father God, just bless us in everything we do, Father God. And we promise to give you all the glory, Father God, all the praise. We ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, Trinity. Good morning. This truly is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. 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 Oh, I see these babies down here, and I am so excited for what God is going to do. I can see him, just see the love of Christ in these babies and how they just clearly see three things and cut through things. Nonsense. They cut through it. They know exactly what they had to do, and they came forth and gave their life to Christ. Amen? Amen. This morning, we have a special treat. We have Imani Emmanuel. I met her when her dad, her father, Reverend Emmanuel, was going through his bout with cancer. I met Reverend Emmanuel when he was a graduate student in my class, and then he became one of my colleagues teaching at Judson University. Well, Amani sings with the Soul Children of Chicago, and I asked her if she would bless us with a song today, Be Ye Also Ready. She's ready to go. So she is going to bless us. So Trinity, please welcome Miss Amani Emmanuel.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to thank God that I'm here on today, on this special day. I just thank God for being here. I already had a song prepared before she even asked me, just in case. But as I was finna sing that song, God led me to another song. And I was like, okay, I got this song already, you know, set. And I already told her, like, two songs. And then I was sitting down, and then God was like, you kidding me, right? You're not going to sing that. So I was like, so this song is called Cast Your Cares Upon the Lord. Cast all your cares upon the Lord, for He cares so much for you. You stop worrying about the things you can't even change, and know that He will see you through. God hasn't given us the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and a sound mind. Cast out all fear and doubt, and know that He will see, He'll see you through. Thank you. I chose this song because when I saw y'all get baptized, oh my God. I'm trying not to get emotional. But when I saw y'all get baptized, it's such a blessing how kids will be willing to go up there. And you have parents and family supporting you when you have kids out there to this day making the wrong decisions, hanging out where they're not supposed to be. But it's a blessing how you see youth wanting to come to church. It's a blessing. I heard how you were so excited and you were counting down the days to get up there. You know how many kids don't even know what this is? You know how many kids I know that don't even know what this is? And you counted down the day. I want to say that I'm so blessed to hear that you counted down the days just to want to be baptized. Like, that deserves a hand clap in itself. I didn't mean to come up here and preach to y'all. I know I'm just 17, but I know what happens inside the youth. Some of you parents don't know what's going on because y'all don't understand, and social media floods in and different programs on kids shows that don't show stuff that's not supposed to be on those shows, and we get distracted from Him. I just want to tell you guys that I am very proud, and I thank God for y'all, and I am going to be standing with y'all as you guys walk through this path of faith and love, because you got each and every one of you guys are special. Any problem that y'all have, give it to Him. He is here. He is standing right here saying, hey, I'm here. Any problem you may have in school, any bullying that you may be going through, anything is not too hard for Him. no prayer that you may have been praying for is not too small or too big. It could be studying for a test, making new friends, walking home from school, hope praying that you'll be safe. Nothing is too small. And I love each and every one of y'all. I know y'all don't know me, but I love y'all. And I just thank God for y'all. I'm done.
Stand in awe of you.
Isn't this the place to be on a Sunday morning? Come on, give the Lord some praise in the house. Give him some praise in the house, church. Amen. So turn with me once again in your Bibles. We're concluding a three-sermon series as we're taking an expositional look at Deuteronomy chapter 6. Focusing today on verses 20 through 25. Now, over the past couple Sundays, as we've taken a look at this, you remember that you've got Moses sharing the word to his congregation of people who the Lord has delivered out of the bondage of Egypt. And they've been in the wilderness for roughly about 40 years or so. The Lord has given them a promise, and he's now pointing them towards the promised land that he's indicated promise to them that he would give unto them. And when we spent time on the last couple of Sundays, we lifted a couple of life lessons from each of the Sunday, and we watched how God was shaping and preparing his people for his promise, for his promises. And he did so by increasing their faith. He did so by expanding their kingdom vision. He did so by enlarging their compassion, their heart of compassion. And he also focused upon the importance of how you begin to pass that on to your children and the importance of allowing God to govern your heart, heart reality. Let him govern your heart and your walk. Let him govern your training and your home, if you will. And then let him indeed govern your hand and your habits. He wants everything. He wants all of you. Last Sunday, we spent a little time together as we looked at that middle passage of scriptures, focusing in on how when God's promises come, there always seems to be a component of temptation that comes alongside, or follows, or tries to interrupt. And in those moments, it's so important for us to remember his word, his proclamation to us, and remember his preparation for us, and trust him. Trust him. Spend a little time also taking a look at how when the world tends to want to pressure you to abandon your faith in Christ and your faith in God, or to even question his word, how it's so important to focus your attention on his grace-filled guidance and his righteous commandments, and then watch how God blesses you. Watch how God blesses you. Today, again, we're focusing on verses 20 through 25, and I think our key verse that I jotted down was verse number 25 for our reading together. We have the King James translation of that. We might need to slide that down just a little bit so my eyes can pick up that entire verse. Thank you so much. You got that in your Bibles? Give me an amen. Do you mind standing with me? Can we read this together as a family and we get our hearts and minds prepared for the word? I won't be long with you. I'll try to be concise. Verse 25, as we read it together, says, "And it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God as he has commanded us." Let's read it again. "And it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God as he hath commanded us." As you take your seats, preparing for God's promises. I like the way this last section opens up. There were three pieces of this that jumped off the page at me as I was studying it afresh. The first thing is how, and I'll get to two, I've got two life lessons. The first component is how God deals with history. Three pieces: history, destiny, and legacy. All that packed into these few short verses. He closes us out, and he brings us to the point where he says it this way in the King James: When your child asketh thee in the time to come, saying, What mean the testimonies and the statutes and the judgments which the Lord our God hath commanded you? Then thou shalt say unto thy son, We were Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt, And the Lord brought us out of Egypt with a mighty hand. And the Lord showed great signs, showed signs and wonders, great and sore, upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon all his household before our eyes. And he brought us out from thence that he might bring us in to give us the land which he swore unto our fathers. Here's my first life lesson if you're jotting. God works in our history to reveal our total neediness, to demonstrate God's loving gratefulness, and to prepare us for his promised goodness. And I thought there might be at least one amen in the house. God works in our history to reveal our total neediness, demonstrate God's loving gracefulness, and prepare us for his promised goodness. Look at how he's laid the groundwork all through the original part of this writing to us by talking about how he's expanding all these components needed. If you're going to walk into God's promise, you need to be prepared for God's promise. And it's he's preparing you for it. So look at how he says now, and when, and when, and when. The question's going to come. Your children are going to want to ask the question. He's told them, share with them what God is doing in your life. Talk about it when you get up in the morning. Let me pass this, paraphrase this thing. He's told us in the beginning, he says, it ought to so permeate you and flow from you what God is doing in and through your journey that it just comes out of your mouth almost automatically. And God ought to be so good to you that when you come into whatever circumstance you face or whatever opportunity you come in front of, that the first thing you think of, well, thank you, Lord, for bringing me to this point in time. Thank you, Lord, for protecting me from all the evil that's around me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me strength to be able to withstand what's coming up against me. Thank you, Lord, for giving me guidance in the midst of this journey. You know I have some decision points to make, and you showed me what to do. He says, when you walk through that journey, and he's talking to folk that are out there in tents now, that have been fed by manna, that did not, weren't able to take care of themselves. Only God provided for them, gave them water out of a rock when they needed something. God was taking care of them in the midst of this thing. And he says to them, I told you how to walk this journey, and I need you to share that. This needs to be generational. You need to, this isn't just for you. So when you get up in the morning, you need to let your children, and first, what is he saying? First of all, he's saying, in your first and most important ministry, I don't even have to say it, do I? Your first and most important priority one ministry is in your home. Huh? So he says, you want to get prepped and prepared and to experience the fullness of God's promises for your life. He says, then steep yourself in this word of God in your relationship with him. And when you do that, and you've got that personal relationship with God through Christ Jesus, I'm on this side of the cross now. And he so permeates you, the Holy Spirit is now indwelling you and now empowering you and guiding you and strengthening you in that component. It will transform your thinking and transform your being and transform your walk of life, if you will. And when you have that permeating inside of you to the point that you're walking with God Almighty, talk about it to your children. When you get up in the morning, talk about it with your children. When you're walking along beside them during the daytime, talk about it with your children. When you settle down in the evening and you're breaking bread across the table, talk about it with your children when you're getting ready to lay down at night, because then you're pouring into your children. Talk about it with your children when you're coming together in the house of prayer, worshiping as a family. And then they'll not only hear your words, but they'll see what God is doing in and through you. And then the text says, and sure enough, your children are going to ask you the question. So it doesn't say if the question comes. It says when the question comes. When they ask you in the time to come, what does all this mean, Mom and Dad? What, you've been talking about the Lord. You shared with us the good news. We're worshiping as a family, and we're and we're and we're you know, you got us down here on church on Sunday mornings, and you know, sometimes you had to drag us to this thing, but you got us here, and it's coming inside of us, and it's making a difference in our journey. And when, you know, I've heard you talk about God's goodness. I heard you reading from the Bible. I see us praying when we get home. We're pouring into your children, he says. Not if, but when the world tries to attack them and bring them all kinds of skewed messages, but yet you pour the foundation of the Word of God inside of them, then the question is going to come. I still got a few minutes. Then the question is going to come, Lord, pastor's paraphrase, Lord, my friends are telling me all kinds of stuff out here that I should be doing, all these places I should be going, all these ways I should be acting, but you have poured into me the Word of God, and the Word of God has given me a truth that I now have something to measure against what the world has to say. So when your son or daughter asks you, what does all this mean? That's what the text tells me. What does all this mean? These statutes, these judgments, these commandments of the Lord, what does all that mean? He says, then this is a rich opportunity for you to talk about your historical context with God. So Moses says, take them to your historical walk. Take them to your history with God. And he pinpoints it as, from a national standpoint. He says, talk to them about how you were in bondage to Pharaoh. Why? Why do my children need to know about some of the struggles that we've gone through, Lord? I mean, what's in that, Lord? Because they can't appreciate where they are until they have some measuring the point of where they've actually come from. You know, you can get real complacent living in that beautiful home and driving that nice car if you don't have a measuring ground against the fact that when those days, when you had an outhouse, I'm going back to the country, you know? Did I go back too far? And you know, there wasn't no car. Most folk got more cars than we had TVs back in my home. He said, give them some context. They need some context to understand and appreciate the blessing that they're living into. They need, and he takes them back here, so let them know what it was like back in the day when you had to make brick and they didn't want to give you no straw. You know, tell them what it was like when Pharaoh was whipping on your back out there and you were enslaved and in bondage. Let them know what it felt like when you couldn't come together to worship and talk about how good God is. Let them know what it felt like to be all locked up and you couldn't express yourself and you couldn't be who God is. So it's trained you to be and desired for you to be, because something about that history will help them to appreciate their present and have a true appreciation from God Almighty. Can I talk to somebody in the house today? And then not only, because you don't want them to be stuck in your history. So when you put them in the context of where you come from, where the family has come from, and then tell them about how God delivered you. Because that's the good news that we came to talk about. Because if we're all stuck in our historical context, then there's no way we can be who God has designed us to be, because we're all back into that. So you're still carrying around luggage that the Lord has freed you from. You need to set that mess down and let God set you free. Because anyone who knows the Lord, the text tells me, is free indeed. So remember your history and take the life lessons from it, but walk forward without the baggage, but with the life lessons from your history. He says, you were in bondage, but God brought you out. And he said, he brought you, I love this phrase, he brought us out so that he could bring us in. Did anybody catch that other than me? He didn't just deliver us from bondage and say, figure it out. Now that you're free, figure out what you're going to do with that. He brought them out with a promise. I'm going to free you from the bondage of Pharaoh, and I promise your forefathers, and I'm promising you that there is a promised land for you to go to. Oh, wait a minute. Thank you. Somebody got that. So you may still have the smell, a little bit of the stain of your history, but that's not who you are. That's not who you are. I could stay there for a while. So I love the way God, he works. So he weaves, he says, because your children need to, this is a generational teaching and learning that we need to be able to pass on to our young ones. When we talk about Christ, we need to be able to talk about it with the context of what he's done for me, how that wisdom I can pass on to you, so that as you face the world today, when all that is, it will try to confuse you with, you know that you have a standard in the Word of God and a power in the relationship with Christ that enables you to know who you are in the midst of the battle and to know that victory has already been won and you don't have to worry about it. As a matter of fact, I heard the writer say that I'm more than a conqueror in Christ Jesus. Victory has already been won in him. Can I preach this thing like I'm in Trinity? He brought us out from thence that he might bring us in. And he didn't just bring us in, he brought us in with purpose to give us the land which he swore unto our fathers. I tell you, I could preach a series on that one verse right there. That's awesome. The faithfulness of God demonstrated in the neediness of man, in the weakness of man, in the process of a wilderness journey, when everything around you is telling you that you could be crushed down, you need to be fearful, doubtful, and anxious. In the midst of that, you still have God's promise that I'm not only going to bring you out, I'm going to bring you through and into the promise that I promised for you. Come on, somebody. Get just a little bit happy in the house here today. I got to hurry on. I'll be here for a while. The second life lesson comes from these last two verses of the chapter. 24 and 25 says, and the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that he might preserve us alive as it is at this day. And it shall be our righteousness if we observe to do all these commandments before the Lord our God as he hath commanded us. Closed chapter. Second life lesson is this. I said in the first, God works in our history to reveal our neediness, our total neediness, demonstrate his gracefulness, and prepare us for his promise, goodness, and righteousness. God speaks into our destiny to confirm our reverence for him and strengthen our resolve in him to fulfill his purpose and his plan for our lives, and to establish a kingdom legacy of faith, fellowship, and followership. I might have made that last word up. I like doing that. And when your son asks you in the time, saying, what does all this mean? Mom, Dad, what? I heard you talk about what it was, you talked to us about what it was like back when we were down in Birmingham. What does all that mean? When you shared your stories about days in Baltimore, what does all that mean? When you talked about your days back down in New Orleans, what children say, what, Dad, Mom, Dad, what was all that about? When they reached back into Tennessee and Virginia, and my children started asking, Mom, Dad, what did you talk about your context, your family, your history, your walk of faith back in the days? What does all that mean? It shows how God was so intimately and lovingly involved in every step of the process of our journey. How he cares about every single hair on our head. He's noticing every single move that we make. He's guiding our path. He's giving us wisdom, showing us teachable moments and life lessons all through the journey. And when we have when in our weakness we have a tendency to fall down or to make mistakes or to be frail or to be anxious or to be doubtful, He knows us inside and out because he designed us, he made us, and he has this way of propping us up on our, I love what the old folk used to say, propping me up on my leaning side. On my leaning side. He knows I don't have enough strength to straighten up my back in the midst of all this mess that's coming down on me. And if I could, I would. And so he puts a divine prop underneath, oh, come on, mother. He puts a divine prop underneath my leaning side so that he can straighten me all up and I can stand tall in him. Because I need to be able to stand tall in him, but not just for me, but for my family. And he says, follow what the Lord, there's a destiny when you trust God. There's a destiny to be fulfilled. He has designed inside of each and every one of us uniqueness and beauty and giftedness. And the only way that we can get it out is if we walk in faith, trust in Christ Jesus, walk in his word, and allow his fellowship to give us the strength that we need as we face the journey and the obstacles today. So he says, I need to go. And the Lord commanded us. You ask what he says? The history is we've been through some stuff. The power reality is that he brought us through some stuff. The beauty of the future is that it was based on the promise that he gave me even before I stepped into the stuff. And so even though I'm walking in the muck and mire of the world, there's a promise that has already been given. I'm at point A. I'm at point A. He's telling me I'm going to get to point Z. In the middle of that is life's process. Don't lose sight of point Z that is the promise. Even if you're at some different part of the process, God is still faithful. He's still faithful. That you might give God the respect and the awe that is due him. That you would walk in his statutes, his teachings, his wisdom, the mind of God revealed in the word of God. And that he might, in the process, preserve you. That's a conditional promise. You walking in that, God is faithful to preserve you. And it shall be righteousness. Right relationship, right standing, right living. I mean, he empowers all of that. That's all him. Working in and through us before the Lord as he hath commanded us. And he just calls us to be obedient and to be faithful and trust him. His promises are greater than anything we could hardly imagine. Blessings are greater than anything we could hardly imagine. And his love, how do you wrap your mind around the love of God to folk like us, which is all of us, who struggle in our worldliness? And yet he loves us. And yet he pours into us. And yet he comes through and speaks in and through us. And yet in the midst of my fears, he comforts us. In the midst of my worries, he guides us. When I try to find ways to go back and pick up the old man, he reminds me, but that's not who you are. You're a new creature in Christ Jesus. When I try to get stuck in my history, he reminds me of my destiny. And as I march towards my destiny, he reminds me that it's not just your destiny, it's about legacy. So it doesn't stick here. It hits here and it passes on to the next generations. And so whoever you're mentoring comes up and asks the question, what does this all mean? You say, well, you know, once upon a time back in Virginia, we had this thing going on. This is what we did. And through it all, I began to understand God's guiding, loving hand on us, on me. And even though I didn't recognize it at the time, he was loving and guiding and protecting and providing and giving me peace. When my mind might have been focused on being the best athlete in town, his focus on how can I make you a child of God. We might work through a little basketball, but the ultimate goal is not to make you the best basketball player, to make you a son. So what do you think about today? I'm coming home right now. What goes through your mind when God says, when God speaks to you through his word, and he says there will come a time when someone will ask you the question, what does all that mean, this Christian stuff, this walk in Christ stuff, this worshiping in the house stuff? He says, when that time comes, don't worry, don't fret. The beauty of the moment is that God, the Holy Spirit, has a way of giving us the very things we need to say to speak into the mind and the heart of who he sent across our path. You don't need to be pulling out your papers and say, wait a minute, let me read you my story. Just tell your story, whatever God guides you to tell. And when your children, man, our children run past us so fast today. It's lightning fast, their schedules, the things that are going on. As the Lord blesses you with those moment-by-moment opportunities, talk to me, parents. Take the time to speak into their lives the grace and goodness of Jesus Christ and the power of this word. And then let them continue to see you live it out. Even with some of its, weaknesses. Because it gives them context. They need to know that if they fall down, the Lord can beat them back up too, Is that all right? And share it. And he says that will be God preparing you and preparing them for the great day of promise that he has fulfilled into them, their history, their destiny, and now their legacy. So, Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this moment. We thank you for these young folk. We thank you for the families that come out and raising them up and building, pouring into them, and for allowing us to be a part of this journey. We pray that you're touching and have touched someone's heart today, igniting in them a passion to know you better, to walk with you more faithfully in fellowship, to grow in you continuously, and to be more obedient to your call and direction. So now, Lord, as we open up the doors of the church and we extend the arms of fellowship, move as only you can move. It is in the precious name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ that we lift this prayer up to you with great expectation. And we thank you, Lord, for this day. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Let the church say amen. As we stand together, we never leave God's house without opening up the doors of the church and extending an invitation to you if you're here and you're seeking a church family. Simple step of coming down front and let us welcome you in your Christian experience or as a candidate for baptism. There is nothing better. Lift your voice. Nothing better than knowing Jesus. He will pick you up. He will pick you up and turn your life around. If you hear the Lord speaking, won't you come? You ought to know him. Know him. Get to know him. Lift it. Get to know him. Right now, today, just come. The Lord's touching your heart. Won't you come? There's nothing better. Nothing better. Then knowing Jesus,
He gets sweeter as the days go by.
As the days go by, you ought to know him.
Get to know him.
Get to know him. Right now, today, just come.
And because we love you, we open up our arms to you. We say, come on, come on, come on.
Come on, come on, come on. Right now, today, just come.
Come on. Arms open. Come on, come on.
Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Right now, today.
One more time,
just come.
Come on, lift our voices one more time like we mean it.
Come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on. Right now, today, just come.
As you take your seat. We want to close out today by recognizing our young people. Our new family members have been baptized today. I want to, first of all, I never want to go too far without in the program without thanking our deacons' wives, our deaconesses, for blessing us and preparing everything. Thank you, ladies, for being such help, getting this all together for us. I follow the deaconess. Trinity Riggins. Come on up here, sweetheart. And if you stay on stage, God bless you. Congratulations. Stand right over here. How about that? We're gonna take some pictures after this is over. Can we I take a picture with you? Maybe. Okay. Maybe. Okay. Shariah Cobbs. Maybe. Sharasia Cobbs. Amen. Thank you. Congratulations. Jason Cobbs. Congratulations. Zaya Liddell. There you go, sweetheart. Jonathan David Allen Murphy. I like that. That's my guy.
They do.
Amen. Amen. And Kyle Matthew Harvey. Yes. Oh, too sharp. Let's give them a hand clap of praise. Amen. When we close, we're gonna line them in front when we close, after we close with our benediction. If you have a moment, we've got refreshments in the narthex. Join us for refreshments. But if you have a moment, come on down and shake a hand and give them that, you know, that good old school right hand of fellowship. You know, like back in the day we always did. Somebody nod at me like you remember back in the day. Well, okay, I just wanna make sure we're in the same mindset. Take your neighbor by the hand, let's close with our benediction. I'll step in the middle of this. How about that? Can I do that? You were just touching the gray. With our heads bowed and with our eyes closed and our hearts humbled before the living God, as we assume an attitude of prayer and lifting our hands to him in praise. Now unto him who is able to keep you and me from falling, and present us faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power,
now, henceforth, and forevermore. Let all God's people say amen and amen. Holy.
Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Lord God Almighty.
God in three persons.
God in three persons.
Blessed Trinity.
Blessed Trinity.
God bless you and God keep you. Give somebody a holy hug before you leave. Come down and meet our new young folk here, our new member folk.
God is open.